Well, it's great to be here in Deerfield Road. I just bring you greetings from the land of milk and honey and skinny jeans and pour-over coffees down in the cathedral campus. It's the way we do it downtown, but it's so good to be with each and every one of you. And I just want to say something before we get into God's word. A couple things. One, not one person came to church to hear from me. I love the love that was shared, and you can continue that applause throughout the sermon if you'd like. But the reason why you came is because you want to hear a word from the Lord. And in the days that we live, we truly need a word from the Lord. The other reason why I came is because we're family. I'm just your crazy cousin from down south that had an opportunity to come up. It's great to see a couple from my small group that are here from the cathedral campus. And we love your pastor, Pastor Jason, and his wife, Terry, and the kids. We were stranded in a very rough place together last summer for the better part of a month, St. Vincent. And I learned something during that time as we were in St. Vincent. I learned that God's people don't pray for you when you're in certain places. You know, if I was doing urban ministry or, you know, in the Far East or something like that, people are just pleading the blood of Jesus and just longing for God's revealed manifest presence to be with their pastor. But then I said, we're stranded in St. Vincent. It's like, hello, anybody at Harvest? Is there anybody there? But it is so good. When you're stranded with people, you get a chance to get to see who they really are. And just love you all's heart for the Lord. Love your heart for the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm excited to be able to share the word of God with you today. It's been beating me up for the better part of the week, so there's great joy in being able to share it with you. And I pray that as you hear the word of God, as we continue the Satisfied series, I pray that you would be blessed, but I also pray that you would be challenged to go another step with Jesus Christ. So before we get into God's word, let's go to the Lord, and let's ask him to speak through it to us today. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to share your word in such a beautiful place. God, your people have come to hear a word from you. And so I pray more than anything that it would be less of me and more of you. Less of me and more of you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I've been enjoying listening and being under the preaching of this book, Colossians. I know it seems like we've been in it for 6 months. But we promise we're going to get to the end. But today we're in chapter 4, so I'm going to ask you to grab your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, let me invite you today. Grab a Bible that's in front of you. Take your neighbor's Bible. They won't care. Lean in, because I want you to see these words, these precious words of God on today. And as I was getting into God's word and reading it, it reminded me of the story of a person in my life. Her name is Edith McGill. None of you know Edith, but some of you may have a chance to meet her in heaven one day. She didn't make it past a fourth grade education, and she was the church mother in my church. See, in my church, the elderly are esteemed and honored. And they're not esteemed and honored because they make good biscuits. They are esteemed and honored because they love the Lord Jesus. And so Edith McGill was a woman who prayed. She was an intercessory prayer warrior. And I remember when I was 17 years old, about this time of year, we had a little thing called graduation. And Edith McGill was sitting on that front row after the service. And she just motioned to me to come over to the pew. And I came over to the pew, and she put her arm around me, and she said, "Son, you're going to college, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes, ma'am, I'm going to college." And she looked at me, and she said, "You go get your learning, but don't lose your burning." And I was like, just this amazing 81-year-old woman, the wisest woman that I ever met in the area of prayer. And when she prayed, you felt the presence of God. It was because she actually believed what she was praying. She actually believed that prayer wasn't something for her to get something from God. It was for something for her to get to know God. And in our passage today, Paul continues and he is encouraging us in how we should have wisdom and how we witness, How do we wisdom do we witness? But he didn't focus on speaking. He focused on the power of prayer. So read along with me as I read from the ESV. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it. I love that, being watchful in it, with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us, that God may open to us a door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. And then verse 5 and 6, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, make the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt. I love that. So that you may know how you ought to answer each person. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of his word. Just as a little bit of a primer, some of you have been with us, so you know this. But Paul is writing this from jail. Paul has a very interesting resume, and I'm pretty confident that 90% of the people under the sound of my voice would not have been a member of his church. I know you guys love Paul. I know you claim to be followers of Jesus, but I'm pretty confident today that none of you would go to his church. So let's just revisit a little bit who we're talking about. Yes, he's written a lot in the New Testament. He is seen as a champion of the faith, but just for fun, Paul liked to kill deacons. He was single. And oh, by the way, we should probably say that he spent quite a bit of time as a convicted felon in jail. So I'm just curious. I don't want the elders to raise their hands, but you're looking for a pastor 20 years from now, and you're just like, oh, let's just kind of look at these resumes of who we could have and call as our pastor. And he shows up and he says, yeah, dude, I don't have a wife, been in jail quite a bit. Loved Jesus, killed a few people. In fact, one, his name was Stephen, and I was there and witnessed it, one of the pillars of the faith. But I'd like to be the pastor of this church. I don't think anybody would say yes. But we start to see that he was a changed man. Something happened to Paul that he stopped being that person, and he became the person who penned these words. And he starts by reminding us, point one in your notes, pray expectantly. Pray expectantly. It says, be prayerful, continue steadfastly in prayer. That word translated means to have a continuous lifestyle of prayer, that prayer is not an event. Prayer is a process. That we as believers, we don't just come to prayer as a moment, but it's something that we persist in. Oftentimes you hear people talk about prayer being a labor. That what does it mean for us to be busily engaged and devoted to prayer? Ephesians 6:18 is a verse that just has been seared into my conscience this week. It's just a few pages to your left. It says, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. In these first two verses, Paul is outlining what prayer looks like in three different ways. And the first is intercession. What does it mean for us to be steadfast in prayer? But then he moves to being watchful in prayer. Being watchful in prayer. What does that mean and what does that look like practically? A couple years ago, I came on staff at Harvest and I noticed something early on in our campus staff meetings. I noticed that we immediately after prayer went into planning for the next part of the week. There's nothing wrong with planning, amen? There's some people who put together a lot of time, and we're so thankful for the worship team and all of those that have put this service together. It's really good that people actually think about those things. But one thing I noticed that was absent from our staff team meetings was reflecting back on what God did the last week. And so I instituted something at the beginning of all of our staff team meetings. I call it looking for Jesus activity. And all we do is we sit around and we say, where did you see God move last week? Where did you see God move in your small group? Where did you see God move in your life? And the first two meetings were incredibly boring because I realized that people weren't thinking about what God had been doing in their lives. They weren't being watchful. Something happens when you're watchful. Your perspective changes. You start to see that there's something that's greater than you that's going on, that you're a part of something much bigger. So when I go to the staff team meeting this week, I'm going to be able to talk about the breakfast that I had at Deerfield Road. I'm going to talk about the anointed waffles that I had and the conversation that I had around the table. I'm going to be able to talk about how my son was cared for in Harvest Kids. I'm going to be able to talk about people that I saw that I went on mission with last summer and see how they're faithfully serving the Lord Jesus. Because when you're watchful, your perspective changes. And you start to see the answers to the prayers. How many times do we gather and we pray for things, but we don't revisit? Hey, how's Tom doing? Yeah, I know he had surgery last week. How's he doing? Have you had a chance to talk with him? Oh, praise God, he's doing a little better. We had a person on our worship team that texted us last night about 6 o'clock. And he told us that he wasn't going to be on the worship team this morning because his roommate had been hit by a car yesterday early in the morning in Chicago. He and his wife were hit by a car, and they were rushed into surgery because blood was on his brain. I'm pleased to let you know that he's out of surgery, and he's doing much better. But we're being watchful because we're in prayer together continuously as we go through the day. But it's not just being steadfast in prayer. It's not just being watchful. But listen to the end of that verse, with thanksgiving. I could just shout and run all around this room right now about thanksgiving. When you pray with thanksgiving, I think we should have a sign that says, don't pray without giving thanks first. I don't care what the prayer request is. I don't care what's going on. We're going to give God thanks for who he is before we ask him for anything. Why? Because when we give thanks, our attitude changes. When we give thanks, we put the proper authority and the proper, if you will, admonition to where the power comes from. It's the Lord. I've seen this as we get together as pastors. We are doing and dealing with so many different things as a church in this day. And I love that we start with gratitude. It starts with how we greet each other with a hug. I love violating people's personal space. My favorite time of the service is the welcome. My wife can tell you it's not hers, just newsflash. But I love hugging people. I love shaking people's hands. I love looking in people's eyes and seeing how they're doing. It's not an act. It's who God created me to be. But it's because when I give thanksgiving, it takes me to a different place in my walk with Jesus Christ. Something lifts in my spirit. I can tell you that yesterday I was very tired. There was a lot of meetings we've been in and just emotionally, just everything. I was a little tired. But this morning I told Pastor Jason, I heard a couple songs and I was ready to preach 8 services if the Lord asked. I was ready to go. Why? Because there's something that happens when we give thanks. And I love Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. It reminds us to be anxious and nothing, but in prayer and supplication, give thanks. That's what the Lord is trying to help us all as a church to understand, that we can be prayer warriors by interceding. We can be prayer warriors by being watchful. We can be prayer warriors by certainly giving thanks. And then Paul says something that's incredibly intimate. At the same time, meaning simultaneously, not even a gap, at the same time, pray also for us. Who is us? Well, thank you, Jason. I'm glad you asked who us is. If you go back to Colossians chapter 1, where we began the journey, he says that he and Timothy are writing, bringing you greetings. So I'm asking you to pray for me, and I'm asking you to pray for Timothy. Why would Paul ask a personal prayer request? I know you're good Bible students, so just hold on. Don't get ahead of me. But I want to ask the question, when's the last time that you asked someone to pray for you? When's the last time that you asked someone to pray for you? Charles Spurgeon wrote a few sermons in his day, was giving a tour of someone of the church. And it's a very interesting story. It's been many times told. Some of you probably have heard it. But I think it bears repeating because as I was downstairs, it reminded me of this. The man asked him, what is the power and the source of the ministry here at this church? He said, would you come with me? Before the service, he went downstairs, and in the fellowship hall were hundreds of people in intercessory prayer. They'll be praying for me while I'm preaching upstairs. Now let's keep going in the tour. Didn't have to go in a lot of explanation. Didn't have to share a whole lot more. The prayer and the understanding that they understood that we don't bring anything but the sin that makes our salvation necessary. I'm glad and I'm thankful that I get a chance to preach the Word of God. But I am nothing outside of the Holy Spirit breathing through me. I ask people to pray for me every time that I share. But that's easy to ask people to pray when you're getting ready to preach. When's the last time you asked for someone to pray for you when you were going through? I remember a season in our lives. My wife and I we didn't have children, and we were trusting the Lord that maybe we would be able to have a child. And it's really humbling when people in the church come to you and you have more faith for them, Pastor Greg, than you have for yourself. And praying for their children, baptizing people, leading Christ, going to hospitals and looking and seeing after the people of God and loving every bit of it. But there was one area in my life that I would refuse to pray for. It was a child. It had been 5 years, and people were funny. They don't know what to say to you after 5 years of being married, you know, and you don't have any children. First 2 years, oh my goodness, you guys are so cute. When are you guys going to start your family? Year three, your family starts asking questions. Your mother-in-law starts hugging you a little tighter. And then five years, it starts to get a little silent. Because people don't know what to say to you. It wasn't until year nine that the promise was fulfilled. And I remember coming to church just like this. The sermon wasn't even over. And I just got up out of my seat and came and laid on the altar and wept like a baby. And I remember the pastor putting his hands on my back and saying, son, God sees. He didn't have to have a whole long conversation with me. All I remember was people around me laying hands on me. My wife joined me at the altar. And people just laying hands on us. They didn't know what the prayer request was. But I was done. I was through. I couldn't do anything more but call out for the Lord. I don't know if you've ever been in that place. But that was me. And the Lord blessed us in his time with a child. But he continues with the answer of why he asked. Because everything I just said pales in comparison to why he asked them to pray. He didn't ask for personal comfort. He didn't ask that his life would be better. What does the Bible say that he asked? He asked that God may open to us a door for the Word. Are you kidding me? Remember, he's in jail. It's not the Four Seasons. He's not getting meals brought to him on regular occasion. He's in jail, and he asks, if you all would please pray for us, that we would have the opportunity to share the word of God. When's the last time that you said, Lord, if it would be your will, give me the opportunity to share the word of God in Deerfield Road? God, on the North Shore, if it would be your will, could you just give me an opportunity for someone in my pathway today that I can share my testimony? God, if it would be your will for you, because of my neighborhood, would you just anoint me to be able to say something to somebody in the next 2 hours that would just give you glory? Do you think God would honor that request? I'm just going to step out on a limb. I don't want to presume to speak for God. I'm just an oracle of God. But I'm going to say that he's going to be very faithful to that prayer request. He asked, would he be allowed to do this? And you know what's interesting about that? Is that as we study the life of Paul, two things come out very clear. He asked that they would be able to share and open a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ. The mystery of Christ wasn't a mystery to Paul, and it's not a mystery to us, but it was a mystery to many people in that day. Chapter 1, if you go back to our sermons, they're all online. Feel free to listen to this. But chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, Paul gives us a sneak peek. The mystery of Christ was a mystery to the Gentiles who he was called to. So here it is, Paul is asking for an opportunity to preach the word of God to Gentiles. Let me just add a little bit more mustard to the hot dog that we're enjoying this morning, because it wasn't just that he was asking for an opportunity. It wasn't just that he was asking to go and speak to Gentiles. Acts 22, verses 1 through 22, we find out that Paul, as he was talking, there was no problem until he started to talk about Gentiles. Jews had a very serious problem with Gentiles. You don't talk about Gentiles. We don't go to Gentiles. The gospel is not for anybody that is a Gentile. This is us. This is ours. And Paul says, I'm asking that I could have an opportunity to go and do what God's called me to do, to preach to the Gentiles, who, by the way, that's the reason why I'm in jail. Are you kidding me? I'm asking to go to jail some more. Can y'all please pray for me that I would get out of jail so I could go share the gospel and get arrested some more? That's what he's actually asking. I think as Christians today, we need to stop praying for comfort and begin to pray humbly to be placed in places of discomfort. I think that we're so comfortable as Christians that we wouldn't see a problem, an obstacle, as an opportunity for God to work if it slapped us, rolled over us, and backed up again. And here Paul is saying, I want to be a part of the solution. Because here's the thing. Paul knew that found people find people. Found people find people. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was, but now I'm, was blind, but now I'm see. Paul didn't write the words, but he could have. He was literally blinded. God had to stop him because he was so effective at doing the wrong thing to get his attention so that he could help those who no one wanted to go and speak to. There's a tension that the text brings out for us today, though. And the tension is distraction. We are a distracted people. We think of everything else other than loving others. I mean, don't leave me out here hanging. At how many, by a show of hands, could just say, I'm a bit distracted in my life? Thank you. I'm so glad. I'm so glad that I'm not out here alone. I believe that distraction is one of the chief ways that Satan uses to distract us from the mission of God. I'm not going to ask you for a show of hands, but if I could just display up on the screen the number of hours that you've spent online in the last 6 months and the number of hours that you've spent in prayer. I'm curious how many would be guilty, be like, oh, man, I got to pick up on social media. Pastor Ed, I'm really behind. I didn't even know what was on Facebook the last 6 months. I don't think that's generally the case. I think that we're distracted. And by the way, distractions aren't all sin. Sometimes I'm distracted with family things. Sometimes I'm distracted with hobbies that I have. Sometimes I'm distracted my own heart. But the second thing that he says in verse 4 is we are to communicate clearly. In your notes, that we are to communicate the word of God clearly. He's asking that. And I love how he asks it. He says that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. R.C. Sproul has a quote that's famous in the Harvest Pastors circles, that a mist in the pulpit is a fog in the pew. A mist in the pulpit is a fog in the pew. One of the prayers that I had for today is that God's people would leave with great clarity of what the text has said. Why? Because I'm being held accountable to God for how I communicate the word of God. Make it clear means for it to the cause to become known or to disclose or show with clearness. And as I ought to speak highlights the moral and spiritual burden that he has to proclaim the gospel. That there's an imperative that I have. I want to make it clear because I know that people who are listening and they're watching me. And they're listening and they're watching because it's been a mystery to them. So if something's been a mystery, you need to make sure that it's clear so that it no longer is a mystery. And so he's asking for that. And then he goes to the third point. We want you to live wisely. Live wisely. Verse 5 is just so beautiful. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best of the time. Walk refers to the conduct of life. I use a word for years in evangelism. I call it pre-Christians. I don't say sinners. I just say pre-Christians. Oh, yeah, my buddy, he's a pre-Christian. If you're like, oh, my God, that's kind of interesting. Why do you say that? Oh, he just doesn't know about God's love yet. He's a pre-Christian. I'm praying that he would come to the knowledge that how I'm conducting my life is not something that I'm doing just by rote fashion. But I'm trying to conduct my life and walk in a manner with wisdom because the Bible says toward outsiders. I want to hit that point as hard as I possibly can. That living in relationship with an intimate interaction with people both inside and out of the church was always what Christ intended. That we go toward people. Bruce Kuhn, the Broadway actor, is a believer, does the Gospel of Luke completely by memory. It's the most amazing thing. I'm excited when I put three or four verses together and he does the whole book. It's so embarrassing to me. But Luke, he was doing this Q&A afterwards and they were asking him about talking to people on Broadway about being a believer. And he said this, I'll never forget it, in Miami. He said, I've never met a person who has a problem with Jesus. It's the Christians they can't stand. I've never met a person that has a problem with Jesus. It's the Christians they can't stand. And why is that? It's because our walk is not a place of wisdom. People don't want to be projects. People desire relationship. People don't want to be projects. People desire relationship. One of my concerns in the church today is that we spend so much time at church that we don't have time to build relationships with people who are far from God. If I asked you to name five good friends that you have, that don't know Jesus. Could you do it? I didn't say associates. I didn't say a person who's a neighbor. I'm talking about somebody who knows you. Y'all do life together. Maybe you play golf together. Maybe you play cards on Tuesday night, whatever it is. But they know who you are. They're not a family member. And you love them, and they know that you love them. I believe that we need to capitalize on the opportunities that we already have that are around us. One of the hard things about being married to me is people are an opportunity all the time. And so my wife has learned there are times where she just tiptoes and continues on with the life that she has to continue on and do, because she knows that daddy is going to get in a conversation with our neighbor or something, and I'm just going to be, it's going to be 10, 15 minutes, and I need to work on tailoring that down. But it's because people are interesting to me. I just love being with people. I was blessed just listening to Pastor Greg talk about a conversation he'd recently had with his neighbor. People are just interesting when you ask questions and you shut up long enough to listen to their heart. I wonder about you. Do you actually care about people? And then speak graciously, verse 6. Speak graciously. He says, let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. The gospel is offense, but you don't have to be. The gospel is an offense, but you don't have to be. 2 Timothy 4:2 says that we are to be ready in season and out of season to respond, to rebuke, to exhort and encourage with great patience and thanksgiving. I just want to encourage you to bring the love and grace of God with you. Just bring it with you. Be who God's created you to be. And I love that it says, let your speech. Let is an intentional action. Just let it be. Let your speech be seasoned with salt. The Greeks used that phrase, seasoned with salt. I was kind of looking at that. What does that mean? It just said that your speech is never boring or dull. That you're interesting. I don't want you to raise your hands, but are you interesting? Just keep looking at me smiling. Don't look at the person next to you. Because if they're boring, we all know it. But let's give them grace. But I just meet some people in the church, and I'm wondering, would anybody ever want to have a conversation with you about Jesus Christ? Oh, you're loved by God, but you're incredibly boring. You're not interesting. There's no flavor or season to your speech. What church do you go to?
I go to Harvest Bible Chapel.
Who's your pastor?
Pastor Jason.
What campus do you go to? That's a multi-site church, right? Yeah.
Deerfield.
Do you love your church? Have you seen anything that you love? A flower, anything? What brings you joy? The joy of the Lord is our strength, amen? Well, someone forgot to tell your face. Let's be clear. Let's be clear that the joy of the Lord is why we do what we do. Let your speech always be gracious. Maybe some of mine wasn't there. Season with salt so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. I want to close this sermon with some incredible practical tips for you. Because it would be a sin for us to hear the word of God and take it and not act on it. Amen? So I want to share with you in the last few minutes some things that were shared with me years ago that changed how I share the gospel and how I engage with people, and I pray that it would be a gift to you. So I'm going to give you some tips. When to invite someone to church and not get rejected. Because I know that's a question that was all on your hearts. When should I ask and invite people to church and not be rejected? It's interesting, I've learned that when change happens in the life of a person, they're more open to hear the gospel in an invitation. And before we get real spiritual and the people come up, well, Ed, we shouldn't ask people to go to church. We should ask people to come to Jesus. I know that. I'm talking about people who are far from Christ, who love you and who are willing to join you in what you love so that they could hear an amazing message about the love of Jesus Christ. Amen? Birth of a child. The end of a marriage. Moving to another country or city. Starting a new job or starting a new year. The death of a loved one. Failure of a business. Loss of a home. Loss of a job. Starting a marriage. Dealing with a major illness. Every last one of these have been layups for asking a person, hey, would you? Now, remember, let's be wise. My dad died yesterday. You want to go to church with me? No. Spend time with you and just engage. It's just a really simple question. I see that you're hurting, and I don't know. Would you be open to going to church with me Sunday? What's the worst thing that they could do? No, thank you. But you asked. One of the things that I think is interesting is that many of these events, they upset the routines of our life. And I read a book a couple years ago by Charles Duhigg called The Power of Habit, Why We Do What We Do in Life and in Business. And he highlights three cues for developing a habit. And the reason why I'm asking you all to do this, and I'm going to give you the tool, is because I really believe there are people in your life who God loves, who want and need to be invited, not just to church, but in a relationship with Him. That baptism video, I get so excited every week about baptism videos. We go crazy in the cathedral. We've trained our people that when that happens, we tear the roof off the church, because it's because of life change that we do what we do as a church, amen? So Charles wanted to help people understand there are three cues scientifically to a habit. The first is a cue. There's something that's a cue that then starts a pattern, and then there's a reward. So you see a person who's trying to work out and get healthy. There's a cue. Oh my goodness, I went to the doctor. I have high cholesterol. I need to develop a pattern so I get a plan where I get healthier, and then I end with the reward. A friend of ours that used to live with us when we were in Miami, she would go and buy Godiva chocolate and put it in the refrigerator. I still don't know how she did it today, honey. And she would go and just take one little bite and put it back in after the workout. And I'm going, are you serious? I'm the guy who takes the peanut bag of M&Ms and slays the whole thing. But she had learned, if I want to do this the right way, I need a reward. And so the little bite of chocolate was the reward for her. Listen to what Charles says in this book. Some habits have the power to start a chain reaction, changing other habits as they move through an organization. Some habits, in other words, matter more than others in remaking business and lives. These are keystone habits, and they can influence how people work, eat, play, live, spend, and communicate. Keystone habits start a process that over time transform everything. Well, Ed, why are you talking about a business book in church? Well, thank you. I'm glad you asked. The reason why I'm talking about it is because of evangelism. I believe that we need to demystify what it really means to just share our story. And so a church in Atlanta, North Point Church, their staff got together, and they read this book together, and they said, we recognize that we need to help our people in inviting people to church and hearing the gospel. What are some keystone habits that we could develop? And I was in this seminar, and I said, that is amazing. That's really good. So I'm just going to give it to you and act like it was mine. So here it is. There are three things that they taught their people to listen for in conversation. And when you hear them, it's God pricking your heart to do something. Listen for these three knots, N-O-T-S. When you ask how it's going and they reply not well.
when they hear it, oh, not well, something's not well. So it could be potential God moment. A second question, when you hear, I was not ready for and I'm not prepared for, that wasn't expected. I've used that one quite a bit in the last 4 months. I wasn't prepared for what our church was going to go through. I just wasn't prepared. This is not what I expected, and I didn't sign up for this. Actually, you did. It's called the gospel. Come to church on Sunday. It's in my heart. It's literally there. Why am I asking you to come to church? Because other people are feeling the way you are. There's encouragement there. There's healing there. There's forgiveness there. Just come to church. Come to small group. And then the third not statement that they taught was, when you hear, I'm not from here. Oh, it's so good. I'm not from here. Oh, you're not from here? Oh, my goodness. Like, what? I mean, have you been? I mean, it's my favorite restaurant downtown. Yeah. And, oh, by the way, I really love. Wow. That's your church? Yeah. Something I enjoy. Why is that important? Each phrase may indicate an openness or willingness to attend church or to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. So each one of you, when you came in, you received a bookmark. And this is how I'm going to land the plane. I'm going to land the plane by praying for you and myself, because I'm going to ask you to do one thing this week. I'm going to ask you to invite one person to church. It's not complicated. Just open your mouth. Invite one person to church. I didn't say invite them to Harvest Bible Chapel. I'm just asking you to invite them to church to hear the gospel. And so there's a little card and there's some spots. Those spots are not for you to write your name 5 times. But I want to encourage you to think about people in your life who don't know the Lord and are far from Jesus. I just want you to write their name down. You can take it with you. You can do it now. But I want to ask you, and I want to challenge you, to invite one person to church. Well, Pastor, are you going to do that? Yes, and I already did. I invited one of my neighbors to church. Why? Because I think it's a sin to ask the church to do something that I wouldn't do as a pastor. And so I want to encourage you, because you have a beautiful church, and you have a great pastor, and you have a wonderful community. And you have great waffles. Invite somebody to church this week and pray without ceasing. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for your word, and we thank you so much for every person that is here. We fully submit, Lord, to the authority of your word, and we thank you for the model that you've given in Paul, who asked for prayer to proclaim your word. Ask for nothing less that you would give us the courage and the boldness to ask a pre-Christian friend to come to church. We'll be careful to give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.